talk a little bit about how Pan Am's role evolved really as hostilities began, and more importantly, as United States entered the war.
Yeah. So picture, if you will, and the reason I picked Leuteritz out with respect to radio was he ended up developing and sort of perfecting the Adcock Direction Finder, which was a navigational radio technology that was proprietary to Pan American. Nobody else had this technology. And they were still, you know, these highly trained flying boat crews, their navigators were still shooting stars, they were still using dead reckoning, but it was the radio direction finder that could help them pinpoint these tiny little islands. So imagine, if you will, the dawning of a global conflict whose outcome would largely be determined by air power, aviation. And your side, your country, has the one entity, Pan American, that can fly across the oceans. Nobody else could do it. You can't say overnight, but certainly come December 7th and 8th of 1941, Pan Am was thrust to the forefront as a hugely important strategic asset to move material, not in great quantities like surface ships, but safely over, you know, sea battles and the incursion of, say, you know, U-boat forces in the North Atlantic that were sinking ships, you know, left, right, and center, to move people, i.e., you know, high-level military people, and to move intelligence, information. So this was a almost a secret weapon that was developed. And the fact was that the capacity was hair thin, because you know, they had small fleet, single lines, but it was the capability upon which everything else was built, and that would become Air Transport Command, Naval Air Transport Services. So overnight, Pan Am's fleet was handed over, basically conscripted to the U.S. government. Tripp worked out his relationship with Roosevelt to keep his personnel civilian. They actually wanted to put Tripp in front of in charge of Air Transport Command, but he worked out a deferment situation with Selective Service with Roosevelt's blessing, because he knew he could do more in the private sector, so to speak. But they were highly coordinated and communicating, and Pan Am wasn't just rolled in to what would become, you know, these massive airlifts of material. There's comments in the book about, you know, it wasn't like Arnold used Pan Am for the Air Transport Command or CNAC to fly the hump routes in Asia through the back door to China. Air Transport Command was Pan Am. These were the pilots who knew how to do it. These were the navigators who trained thousands of RAF and Canadian Air Force crews and U.S. crews on how to do this, on the technology and the operational procedures to successfully fly across these great spaces. So this was a case of the exact need at the exact moment, and it helped propel the war effort on all theaters.